Well, I have been given the onerous task of introducing the topic to you. We have got four eminent personalities sitting on the dais whom I have been acquainted with for a long period of time. Incidentally, Keul Bakshi was my partner in the profession in the, as a PCS. Mr. V. Sridharan was a council member when I was in the council. He became a committee member of the peer review committee, which is again an important concept of the topic which is under discussion. What the regulators expect from us vis-a-vis the accountability and the responsibility for the audit and certification which we as professionals do. So this is a very, very important aspect where the regulator looks forward to how you can ease the job for him in terms of controlling the corporates which are there in the listed segment. In this complex world, monitoring of the various activities by the corporates is an arduous and a difficult task, and to share the difficulty which is faced by the regulator, we as professionals have been asked to extend our services to them. Accountability and responsibility is cast on the professional to give the regulator some kind of a comfort in whatever job they need to perform. In fact, as was said in the morning session, the professionals are sort of an extended arms of the regulator, if I may say so. So we are the eyes and ears, because our report is duly, diligently followed by the regulator, based on which they can make their own surmisation of the situation which exists in a corporate. We are expected to provide assurance to the regulator for the job which we perform. There is obviously responsibility and accountability cast on us by the regulator for the work which we carry out. We as professionals are therefore expected to play our role cast on us in an unbiased manner. That's very, very important. Audit and certification are two sides of the same coin, if I may very clearly say so. And they are inseparable. In audit, we carry out a process. In audit, we carry out a verification of a process which has happened. So it is slightly more time consuming as against a certification which is an event based one. It is relating to an event which happened for which the certification is done by us. Having said this, I know all of you are very keen to hear the eminent panelists who are assembled over here, and I have certain questions which I will be asking each one turn by turn, and of course you will have the last say in the matter in terms of seeking any further clarification from the panelists on the issues once the initial question answer session is over. Sir, you have seen the topic, the theme, the topic for the panelist discussion. Now, in that connection, I would like to ask you how this can improve, help in making India a compliant India in achieving the government's target of making a corporate compliant India.
Yeah, this will definitely help in achieving the target. So far what happened, that compliance's level was not up to the mark adequate. Regulators did not have machinery to investigate into the affairs of each of the company and find out what is the level of compliance. So when we pitch in as secretarial auditors, there is a feeling within the company that some outside expert is to come going to vouch for each and every action of the company, and therefore the level of compliance will automatically enhance or improve. At the same time, it will percolate down the level and there will be a good compliant culture in the organization. So in my view, this audit and certification, particularly this secretarial audit, will definitely make India as a compliant corporate India, no doubt about it.
Thank you, sir. My next question is to Mr. Sridharan. Now, this is a very ticklish question. I'm sure he's going to have difficulty in answering it also. In the light of the ILFS related scam, what are the lessons for the practicing professionals?
Practicing professionals. The audit profession is in the spotlight for all the wrong reasons. The whole of the last 1 month, 2 months, you have seen enough of it. Scams, with ILFS and IFIN hogging the limelight. You have two types of trial nowadays, trial by media and trial by the regulators. Before the trial by the regulators or the tribunals takes place, the trial by the media is already over. So most of us already know, okay, ILFS means this is what has happened, these are the people. Long back we read, we are all innocent until we are proved guilty. Now we are all guilty until we are proved innocent. So we have become soft targets in a way, as far as the regulators are concerned. This could be my thinking. There's also another line which says that the expectation gap is increasing. Expectation gap of what the regulators want and what we are able to deliver. When I said audit profession, I didn't mean only chartered accountants. After all, we are also secretarial auditors, so we are also falling into the bracket of audit profession now. If NCLT has moved the, if MCA has moved the NCLT for ban for a period of 5 years, in the IFIN case, Deloitte and BSR, which is a part of the KPMG network, it's interesting to see what were the charges which SFIO was levying against them, because it is relevant for us also. They said the SFIO's allegations are 7. Number 1, conniving with the IFIN management to conceal information. Look at the way they use the words, the regulators, to conceal information. Falsifying the statements of IFIN from FY 2014 to 2018. I really pity the company secretaries who have signed the balance sheet now, because as a balance sheet signatory to the financial statement, they would also be, in a way, responsible for this. 3, having knowledge of negative net own funds and capital adequacy. 4, not following auditing standards while checking the accounts of IFIN. This will become relevant to us also shortly now. Knowingly signed all statements. Did not verify the end use of bank finance and NCDs. Then, allowing evergreening of loans to defaulters. What is evergreening? Giving more loans to debt-ridden companies so that they repay the old loans. So it's a cycle. It keeps going on and on. Now with the tightening of the regulatory systems and the supervisory systems, multiple agencies have started probing the auditors. You have MCA, SFIO, ED, Enforcement Directorate, SEBI, and I don't know how many other people are going to join the party as it starts happening. Maybe the service tax people may wake up, the GST people may wake up, income tax people may suddenly find that there is some reason for us to pull something out of this transaction. We don't know how many more regulatory authorities are going to get in. But whether there is a regulatory overreach which is happening is a debatable point. Secondly, criminality is one thing, negligence is something else. The line between criminality and negligence is getting blurred, according to me. Ultimately, let the judiciary and the other decide in a court of law what finally happens. But things are getting a bit scary, and the question arises, who next now? Is it the practicing company secretaries also may get into a precarious position if this kind of thing happens? Post ILFS, what will happen? The relationship between the regulator and the and those who are getting regulated is going to change, because RBI has tightened up, they are merging various divisions, Department of Banking Supervision, Department of Non-Banking Supervision, and Department of Cooperative Banking Supervision. They are merging everything now to consolidate it and have a single point for better control. Secondly, SEBI and the Ministry of Corporate Affairs have entered into an MOU whereby there will be a data exchange of data between MCA and SEBI. So this will provide a seamless linkage and help them in tracking corporate frauds and improving the surveillance level of these bodies. Armed with this kind of a technology, which the government can afford, you and I can't afford this kind of technology. We'll not be able to handle it, simply put. If this is the kind of technology the government is talking about, like artificial intelligence, data analytics, and so on, I think things are going to get very difficult for the practicing company secretaries. In a situation like this, we'll have to really gear up our own systems and procedures in order to keep the regulators at bay if we want to do a proper regular secretarial audit and certification work. That is your perception. I never meant that. What I said was, this is the impression. After reading the media papers, you get the impression that all of us are guilty until we are proven innocent. Ultimately, the courts of law have to decide who is innocent and who is
definitely, most certainly they will do. My next question is to Mr. Pradeep Ramakrishnan. He is from SEBI, all of you know that. As a representative of the regulator, what lapses do you find, or if I may say so, what are the improvement areas you recommend in the second audit reports as far as quality is concerned? Because the regulator has not been too happy about the second audit report, and one of the reasons why second compliance report was introduced was the reason that they're not very happy with it. Let's hear it from the horse's mouth.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before getting answering that question, I think I should say something about this whole fear psychosis that is going around as to the regulators versus the regulated. You know, that is something which is understandable given the gamut of news and information that is flowing as to that the regulators are out to hound the professionals. So I would like to beg to differ slightly, not to say that we also learn, because I was part of the investigation team for the largest known corporate fraud in the country, and we banned one of the big four firm, auditing firms, and probably India is the only country to put a big four firm out of business. So for that number of amount of years. So we have learned from what we did, and though we believe in such that particular case it was a fraud. So the one thing which I want to say primarily is that we believe, and I just heard from Mr. Narasimha about the fact that you did have you had this session in the morning where we the regulators certainly acknowledged that professionals are an extended arm of the regulator. We believe monitoring of listed companies is fourfold. First is the board and the company secretary itself. Then we have the practicing professionals. Then we have stock exchange. Then comes SEBI. So with this background, I would like to get into the particular question which has been put to me on secretarial audit. And even here, I want to give a little bit of history. I have spoken about this at multiple fora, particularly of the ICSI. But since this is the gathering of all the PCS, so I believe I can take a couple of minutes on. See, when SEBI embarked upon the whole concept of corporate governance in the year 2000, if you see the first circular that has been issued, the professionals who were permitted to allow to certify were only chartered accountants. So company secretaries were not permitted, though a lot of these things is, I mean, primarily the whole thing is about compliance, which is the bread and butter of company secretaries. I mean, they are the people who are complying. So in 2003, when we revised the clause 49, I was fortunate to be part of the team which did this, and Mr. Narayana Murthy and company. So the ICSI very rightly also made a representation that company secretaries should be allowed to do this. Despite a lot of opposition from the other institute, we managed to convince the ministry, and that was probably the gate which opened for practicing company secretaries to get into the listed company certification fora. Subsequently, we have had audit of brokers, so many things where we have the practicing company secretaries now there as far as SEBI certifications are concerned. So the secretarial audit was introduced by the Companies Act. Understandably, a lot of practicing professionals were happy because, first of all, it gives them from the commercial point of view. Secondly, from a regulatory point of view, we wanted a check because the financial and non-financial information that is put out by the companies, as far as financial information is concerned, that is audited by the auditors since time immemorial. Non-financial information has never been audited. So we thought practicing company secretaries would do a good job. So permit me to be a little candid here. So initially, when we examined the compliance reports of practicing company secretaries, in fact, I was in Bangalore only. I think it was three and a half years back when there was a seminar on secretarial audit, where a lot of practicing company secretaries were completely clueless as to what to do. and they were, see, the effort wasn't there as much, if I may put it that way, to probably work around it and try to add as much as possible. It was more like, okay, let us go with the checklist approach which is given to us. So when these things were put to us, so we thought that instead of starting to do what Mr. Sridharan was saying, it's not, we are not here to penalize people just for the sake of it. And see, ultimately, the intent is not to penalize. The intent is always to ensure better governance. And ultimately, if we are going to put everyone out of business, then the regulator cannot sit and govern everyone. So we thought that before we got into it, we'll prescribe a format. And this was also as a result of the quarter committee recommendations. So we thought we will speak to the professionals. We spoke to a lot of company secretaries. We asked them what you think is the problem. So they said, please don't prescribe a checklist, because this checklist is something which we can do ourselves, and we, most of us also do. You please highlight what are the things you as a regulator are expecting from the secretarial audit. So secretarial audit being a larger set, a secretarial compliance report is a subset because it deals only with securities laws. So we said that, okay, why don't we start it as an exceptional report? So we worked with the institute, and then we brought out the secretarial compliance report. The secretarial compliance report is largely an exceptional report, if you see, primarily, whereby I was having a discussion with Mr. Andrasubramaniam also today morning, as to, it gives you the flexibility also in the end to add or delete the comments which you want. I mean, you can always say that I would like to say that this company has made this technical violation, but it's not going to impact as much as what we think. We thought that we will do a review after the first sectoral compliance reports are out, so which have already come out. So we'll be doing a report over the review over the next few weeks, and then we would like again ensure that it enriches everyone. So it's not to say that, okay, if someone has done, let's say we are not like your typical school headmaster who's going to look at that, say, okay, this person has left that out and that person has left the other thing out, okay, hang this person. That is not what we want to do, and we are not in that business.
Thanks a lot, sir. There is always one nagging doubt in the minds of all the professionals that now that SEBI has mandated ECS specifically to come out this report, any reporting of non-compliance, there is a dagger hanging on the heads. So this is there.
Yeah.
There is a worry on that.
Yeah.
But anyway, I don't think that should be a worry, because if you do your work diligently, there should not be any problem coming up.
Yeah. So if you permit me to take a minute, more, I'm sorry. See, when we did the secretarial audit, there was a study by the NSE, so it brought out certain things which were very apparent, like even companies, the practicing professionals were not commenting on the fact that the company did not have independent directors and probably women directors. These are all things which are so apparent, these are so technical in nature that the company, we are not asking them to get down to specifics and comment. That is a secondary portion. The primary portion is something whether the company is all right as far as at least the checklist things are concerned. So those things weren't reported, which prompted us to probably ensure what we can do. So I think that's how the whole SCR came about.
I also need to mention one thing over here. The council has decided and the institute has appointed a core group on secretarial audit, which is headed by me, and I have with me two of the members sitting over here, Mr. Vijendra, who is past general manager retired from RBI, and past president of our institute, Mr. Anand Subramaniam. So we will be meeting some of the professionals in this room who are assembled over here. They will be seeking your guidance, your help in terms of revamping the secretarial audit itself. Whatever we are doing currently, is it sufficient? We are looking at getting opinion from views from the stakeholders and putting our views across, and the tacit consent, if I may say so, of the ministry as well. Sir, my question is to my good friend, Mr. Gopalakrishna Hegde. While issuing secretarial audit report, how much can a secretarial auditor rely on the following? The management representation letters, financial certification by statutory auditors.
Good afternoon. In the morning, one of the speakers referred to Dronacharya as an independent director in Hastinavati. During the Kurukshetra war, under the captaincy of Dronacharya, bitter war was taking place. Krishna had to find a solution to put an end to it. He asked Bhimasena to kill one elephant by name Ashwatthama. Bhima killed that elephant. And made a big announcement, Ashwatthama is killed. Dronacharya, he wanted to hear the truth. Satyam Vada, he wanted to hear the truth. He looked at Dharmaraja and asked him, what? Dharmaraja, always known to be speaking only the truth and practicing only what is righteous, dharmam chara. He made a matter-of-fact statement which Drona could not hear in completeness. Dharmaraja said, Ashwatthama hatha. Then Krishna made a noise. Next part of the sentence was not heard by Drona. He said, Kunjaraha. That is elephant. Now, Dronacharya depended upon a person's opinion, third party professional, Dharmaraja. But he did not hear it in totality. He thought his son is killed, Ashwatthama. That has ended with his own death. Here, the point that I am observing are, independent director Dronacharya's weakness was his son. His son was his weakness. So he had to vacate the office. He did it. Dharmaraja, whose chariot always used to move 5 inches above the ground because of his righteous lifestyle and practicing dharma, the moment he made this sentence, it was grounded. Now, when the question is about how far one can rely upon third parties, certificates, reports, here, management representation, yeah. Sir, if you look at our secretarial audit report form prescribed, there is no space for management representation to be mentioned there. Whereas in auditor's report, they talk about director's responsibility statement, DRS, director's responsibility statement. Here also we should have space for that. That is my opinion. Director's responsibility statement, if you look at section 134, subsection 5, proviso F, it talks about the board of directors have devised appropriate mechanism to ensure compliance with all the applicable laws. That statement is made there. Now, elaborating further on that, yes, whenever we get into audit engagement, we should obtain management representation on various aspects of compliances. It should be obtained, but not necessary that that should be guiding our audit exercise as such. Here, that gives you the framework, that gives you their perception and their arrangement. I'll take 2 more minutes, sir. My recommendation is, when we look at management representation, or you mentioned other auditors report, financial certification, we should at times see, generally there can be a statement that you should have your eyes open, mind open, ears open in the course of the audit. I will say, at times you should be deaf, you should be blind, and you should be dumb also. Because when they make a statement that there are
total compliance with respect to this particular statute, except 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I will say you should be blind to the first part of the statement. You should look at the second part. There are the qualifications. One need to focus there and see. During the course of your inquiry, hearing about the systems in place, the compliance mechanism, there again, you should turn your deaf ears to the statements which are okay, normal, which they claim is good and great. Other part, you should have it open. We all know secretarial auditing standards have been released by your institute May 2019. 4 auditing standards have been released, we know that. If with effect from 1st July 2019 itself, they are recommendatory in nature, auditing standard on audit engagement, auditing standard on the process and documentation, auditing standard on forming opinion, and the fourth one, auditing standard on secretarial audit.
The Institute of Company Secretaries of India, in its endeavor,
deviation from the framework of good following the set auditing standards in the process of secretarial audit itself, will invite. Yeah. Then, important requirement is when you rely upon financial certification by a chartered accountant, the auditor, you have to make specific reference to the fact that you have referred to that. You have to further state that the circumstances under which you referred to it and relied on that, you have to further disclose that. That certificate you have obtained from the auditee only. Last important point is, you are free to carry out your own check and test check on these reports that are produced before you.
Thank you, Mr. Hegde. Before I take the next question, I just want to mention one thing for the participants over here. Whatever questions you have, you can send it through Slido by visiting www.sli.do, www.sli.do, and entering the code 20NCPCS, all in capital. In other words, the questions are directly received by Mr. Saurav Jain, and he will print out to the participant, to the panelists who can answer your question.
I repeat it again later.
Now, coming back to KU, right? The question this time is slightly more different. How, in your view, the audit and the reports can help the regulators in lessening the happening of governance frauds in the country, or undertaking proactive measures in stopping corporate governance fraud? So we're looking at how this can help the regulator in preventing or stopping a fraud.
Governance frauds can be classified into different categories. One is financial frauds, where falsification or adjustments in accounts are done, higher profits are shown, or company has earned huge profits, but losses are shown. Number two, misappropriation of assets or funds of the company. Three, corruption. You bribe authorities, you bribe agencies, and get huge benefits for the company. That is the fraud. But there is a fourth category, that is regulatory compliance fraud. So as far as this fourth category is concerned, I do agree that this definitely helps the regulators through this secretarial audit, that there will be lessening of regulatory compliance frauds. However, the present system of secretarial audit is compliance audit. Tick the box kind of an audit. It is not a detailed governance audit. The letters are, I mean, the company must have complied in letters of the law, but in spirit it could not have. Today only I was reading in Economic Times while coming to Bangalore, in Videocon culture matter,
that Videocon had three companies. In one company, the gardener was the director. He was a gardener. In another company, some pitchies or some dummy people were directors. And they told investigating agencies that we were only on paper, we were directors only on paper. Whatever our bosses used to tell us, we were doing that. So, as far as such risks, such governance risks are concerned, where if you tick the box, company has complied. Yes, we have an independent director. But that independent director was a gardener. So therefore, detailed governance audit is not prescribed. I'm sure a day will come while we also excel in our performance and the faith which is reposed in us by the regulators. If we are able to satisfy them, the detailed governance audit may come. And where in such reporting would come? I will give you one example. Even in present scenario, this MR3 or LODR format, what we used to do was that we used to furnish a secretarial audit report in the prescribed format. But we also used to give a letter suggesting the company to improve its standards of governance. I will give you a very small example. Audit committee's functions. One of the functions of the audit committee is to review performance of the statutory auditors and internal auditors. Right? Now, how frauds are taking place? Most of the companies where we audited, there was no such thing. Some companies in the audit committee minutes, it was simply written that the committee reviewed performance of the statutory auditors and found the same satisfactory. So when I asked, how did you find it satisfactory? There was no answer. There were no parameters, there were no benchmarks as to how to review performance of the auditor. And it is the financial auditor who, in connivance with the management or the promoters of the company, are responsible for frauds wherever frauds have happened. So therefore, we gave a separate letter saying that company must evolve a system to review performance of the auditors, and audit committee should intensively deliberate on these aspects and then decide whether the performance of auditor was satisfactory or not, whether he should be reappointed or not. So therefore, in my view, briefly, it will lessen the happenings of fraud, but in the present context, it will not help much. I would wish more.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Repeat what I said earlier. Your question can be sent through www.sli.do and code would be 20 NCPCS, National Convention PCS Conference, right? Thank you. My next question is for Mr. Sridharan. As a secretarial auditor, what are the 10 key points you must check and keep in mind while undertaking the secretarial audit as far as audit of non-financial transactions is concerned?
Not 10, I think there will be hundreds of them. But I will just stick to about 10 of them, which I thought many of the youngsters also would be keen to know. Because those who have been doing it for years would have had some, and hopefully, some system of doing the secretarial audit. Certain thoughts come to my mind and therefore I pen them down and say, let me share it with you. First of all, take up an audit, first of all, only if you feel the fees is reasonable. Don't take up audit for the sake of taking up the audit. You could get into a mess afterwards. Make sure that your appointment is valid. Appointment has been properly done. Whatever the legal requirement are there, make sure that it is done properly so that you don't get into the question. SEBI have also now brought out this question of non-compliances with the adverse remarks made in the previous audit reports. That should also form part of the subsequent reports. So you have to keep in mind what were the non-compliances in the previous reports and ensure that they are properly addressed in the subsequent audit reports. Keep checklists for secretarial audits. Don't just go on, oh, I know the section, I know the rule, and then try to do the audit. It becomes very difficult. With more and more regulation notifications coming, we are not able to keep track of all of it. So best thing is keep a proper checklist for each of the laws which are audited. That will enable you to stay focused on the various aspects of the audit. and make sure that you have sufficient storage procedures, like keeping all the records, whether it's hard copy or soft copy. You need it for the peer review, and God forbid, if you are pulled by any enforcement agency, you will be able to show that you have some records. Hopefully that should not happen. On areas of concern which you have with the management, most of us have areas of concern with the management in secretarial audit. I don't think there's any single secretarial audit where you can say 100% that you have done everything well. There is still some niggling issues, ticklish issues, on which you are not sure, rather not only you, we are also not sure what to do. In such situations, you must engage with the management, try to convince them that this is wrong and therefore I have to report this. And quite often you have very intelligent company secretaries who will tell you that, no, I will get you legal opinion for this. So they end up getting one legal opinion from one of the big law firms which are there, which will be at variance with what you think is the right thing. Then you are in a dilemma, what to do. One hand they give you a legal opinion, one hand you think it is not correct. Now don't ask me how to solve the problem, you have to solve the problem. Management representation letter was also discussed. It is of some help in the sense that you are also making sure that what areas where you have a doubt or areas where you feel that more clarity is required, you're able to get some kind of an evidence from the management. Preferably do a quarterly secretarial audit. Don't try to do it in the end, like April, May, because all companies will try to push you for the reports, saying that board meeting is coming up, give me the report. This serves two purposes. One, when you do a quarterly audit, you know the deficiencies which are there, and the corporates will be able to correct them. Two, if there are non-compliances which have been done, at least those forms can be filed with additional filing fees, and the matter can be resolved. Instead of bringing it out in the end, the report. Corporates prefer that you have a periodic audit instead of doing it at the end of the year. Start FY 1920, keeping in mind the auditing standards. As you know, the auditing standards are recommendatory, but in India, by the time you make people understand and they change, it takes a lot of time. So if it's going to be mandatory from next year, from April, you better start that process now only of educating the clients that these auditing standards require you to do this. Hopefully some of them will start changing during the course of 1920. Then afterwards it will become easy. Areas like related party transactions, one of the worst sections of the Companies Act is the RPT. Nobody understands even now what exactly is this ordinary course of business and what is arm's length. To me, these two things have been the most dense areas in the Companies Act, with management is confirming that everything is at arm's length, everything is in ordinary course of business, putting the practitioner into a dilemma of how he will do it. Second issue which arises is, if these transactions are at arm's length basis and the audit committees have already confirmed that these are at arm's length basis, what is the role of a practicing company in overseeing or overruling the decision of an audit committee? This becomes a very, what you call, ticklish issue for both the practicing secretary and the company secretary in employment. Other than RPT, you have manager appointment and remuneration, and another very what you call, much talked about is the intercompany transactions, intercompany loans and investments, 185, 186 and so on, which always part of various scams is that only, but even as a practitioner, you have to be very careful with these things, RPTs, loans and advances, manager remuneration. Obtain statutory compliance certificate as far as possible, because many companies have the habit of tabling before the board meeting the statutory compliance certificate signed by the company secretary or the CFO or CEO on a quarterly basis at the board meetings. Please take copies of the statutory compliance certificate, which will be of help to you. There is something called a crab mentality. I don't know how many of you have heard about it. Crab mentality. You have? Yes. So taking this statutory compliance certificate, management representation letter, all that is a crab mentality. But for those who, just for a lighter vein, the crab mentality is something like, a man was once walking along the beach and found one fisherman fishing with a bin next to him. So he was catching the fish nice afternoon, and Haramse catching those crabs and putting it in the bucket. Now the bucket was empty, So this man told him, why is your bucket empty? They'll all come out. So the man said, my dear, it doesn't happen like that. If one crab is there, it will come out very easily because it will climb the sides and go out. But if number of crabs are there, they'll all pull the other one down so that everybody meets the same fate. So the idea is, if you want to meet the same fate, it will make sure that all the crabs are pulled down. So that's why the lid is not kept closed. So crab mentality is one kind of thing. Then you have the disclosure of interest of directors, which is generally taken little lightly, but sometimes it can be very serious. The directorships in other companies, issues like that, recording in the board meeting when it's properly. A lot of education is required for the corporates even now. And with regard to video conferencing, the manner in which video conferencing is held, whether their video conferences are really held, what are the backup data the company is keeping. I think in some of these 8 or 10 points which I've just now brought out, there is need for us to be very careful and we should keep in mind in Secretary of Audit. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'm glad you gave only 10. More very specific one. How do you overcome the opinion given by a Big Four and say, look, your views are contrary, but I would like to know some secret on that. Maybe data. In person. My question next to Pradeep. It's again a related question to whatever you already spoken, but still, from the regulator, there will be better clarity if it comes from the horse's mouth. What is the objective, the genesis of bringing out the annual secretarial compliance report? People say it's just a duplication of what is already there in the secretarial audit report. I don't say. People say, right? And in terms of, it's not under Regulation 24A, the one doubt which I have in mind, the only under 24A is talking about the secretarial audit for all the listed entities and material unlisted subsidiaries. So this is part of the circular only, it's not part of 24A as such. And what is that then required in terms of the secretarial audit report? How is it different in terms of secretarial audit report which is prescribed under Section 204?
Yeah, see, like I was answering earlier about the fact that the secretarial audit report, at least the reports which we reviewed, did not meet the requirements which we thought would come from the secretarial auditor, and we are more concerned with securities laws. So that is the reason why we brought a separate secretarial compliance report, which is meant to be a subset of the main report. The secretarial compliance report is not going to be a standalone thing, it is only going to serve the main report, which is the secretarial audit report. Which is why I've been swamped with questions as to, can there be two different auditors? Can there be one person doing the secretarial audit report and someone else doing the secretarial compliance report? So that's the choice of the company, but ideally it's better if both are done by the same person, because this is only going to be a feeder for the other report. So the efficiency is something which we also want to test. Like I said, we are awaiting all the reports. We have received reports. We are going to see whether the reason why we got into this and we have prescribed this was initially after examining the secretarial audit reports, we found that it was not coming out. And like we are saying, many small technical things are also not being highlighted. So we believe that this format has been done after consulting the company secretaries and the institute. So we believe, and we have in fact asked company secretaries as to what do you believe would add to the efficiency of this report, and that is how this has got evolved. So we'll have to wait and watch. So maybe after 2 or 3 months we'll come out with the report, and then we'll find out as to whether it has met its objective for which it has been launched. But I sincerely believe it will, because I think it's largely a very, it is an exemption based report also, where the company secretary, practicing company secretary, is given the freedom also to comment on things other than what is normally prescribed. And like probably the second report will also highlight the compliance status of the company with the observations which he has done earlier.
Right.
You know, so.
There is one doubt on this. I'm sure it will be lingering in the minds of many of professionals who are seated over here. Now, this is not part of 24A. It is a separate part of the circular only. And this secretarial compliance report is applicable for all listed entities. In other words, there is some certain exemption given under Regulation 17 to 24 for certain categories of listed entities. So secretarial compliance report, there is no exemption for such categories of companies, correct?
See, we have got some queries on this particular issue. So we have sort of told them that this SCR is largely a subset of the SAR, so it may not be required as of now. Because ultimately, if you see, 70 to 24 is all corporate governance provisions. So corporate governance provisions are ideally the ones which perhaps could not be met with by SMEs. So though there is no, the SCR is not directly mentioned under 24A, it is actually a subset of the SAR only. So as of now, so we have only given a couple of oral clarifications that SCR is not applicable for SMEs.
The BSC has given a written clarification, it is not applicable.
Yeah, it is.
While we have not heard anything from SEBI, but it will be, it would have been better 24A or AA can be made, where SCR is also mentioned, applicable only to listed entity. Then there will be a lot more clarity in the subject. That's what I felt.
Yeah, so maybe probably the only niggle is whether it is applicable to companies which are SMEs or up to 25 crores who have this.
Exactly.
So I think.
25 crores and 10 crores.
Yeah.
My next question is to my good friend, Mr. AK. Do you think that there cannot be a straight format or a straight jacketed format of reporting of central audit?
Yes.
Do you think there cannot be?
Yes. Yes.
It's all yours.
Friends, when we look at the appointment of secretary auditor, it is done by four of their person. And secretary auditor is required to report to the members. Reporting is to the appointing authority. Where here it is different. Board of directors appoint secretary auditor, but auditor reports to members. I strongly feel there is a need for an amendment in the act itself. Further, auditor's report mainly deal with forming an opinion and expressing it in respect of the compliances for which board of directors are responsible, in respect of maintenance of records which are free from misstatement and as per the requirement of the law. Again, responsibility of board of directors. Then the board structure, the board processes, the mechanism, Mr. Pradeep has mentioned 2 minutes back that the basic reporting on independent directors appointment, non-appointment, this aspect also not covered there. Mm-hmm. When auditor's report, secretary audit report is touching upon all these aspects, we have to make a provision there for DRS. The cricket fans, you will be very familiar with this DRS, decision review system, and we count there on the screen of the TV. Similarly, DRS here, I mean, director's responsibility statement, it should find a prominent place in the secretary auditor's report. Number two, auditor's responsibility statement, that also should find a place there, so that the person who reads the report understands the limitations of that report itself. A report is not guaranteeing anything. The company secretary is expressing his opinion. He does not guarantee anything. In case of certification, it is certification of the true fact mentioned in the certificate. 100% assurance on the truthfulness or accuracy of the data mentioned in the certificate. In case of report, no. It is his opinion which has been formed based on following the process of the audit, looking at the audit evidences obtained and following the auditing standards prescribed. Third party, the professional reports may be in case of tax audit report, total prudence report, technical auditor's report, in some cases, even the departmental proceedings against the company also can form a valid document for the auditor to form an opinion. To capture all these things, I strongly feel this format should undergo a change. Now that our institute has come out with auditing standards, for which I congratulate our beloved president, Mr. Ranjit Pandey, and his team of council members. Sir, take it up further for addressing the issues of this format, MR3. You'll do it. Fantastic. Thank you.
Hello. Yeah. We also have with us Mr. Vinit Chaudhary, who is chairman of the Auditing Standard Board. My next question is to Mr. Kiyur Bakshi. Just looking at what are the consequences of a false statement in a report, missing out less relevant aspects in the report, which may not be of great significance, but we miss out. Missing the most relevant information of the company in the report. So you got three. One is false statement, one is missing out less relevant, one is missing out extremely relevant information, right?
Yes, I will take liberty to change that sequence and first come to the less relevant. See, the audit is one principle of materiality. Whether the lapse or a default is material or not. And then most of you who have audited, who have undertaken central audit, will find that there is some problem, one or the other. Small problems in every company. Non-compliance of some sectoral standards, for example. Now, reporting these may not help. Ultimately, what is the objective of this audit? If you report that one of the directors has not signed attendance register in one of the meetings, how important is this? I mean, are you for this? You are supposed to do something much bigger. So therefore, in my view, less important or less relevant aspects can be skipped. But as I was telling while I was replying my earlier question, that we give a letter along with the central audit report wherein we detail all these small lapses. That during the course of our audit, we have also found the following lapses and we request you to regularize the same in due course of time. For example, signature was not taken on attendance register. It can still be taken now. So, your report can skip this and consequences, as far as consequences are concerned, the reply lies in section 448, read in section 447 of the Companies Act. 448 is punishment for false statement, right? Now, 448 states that any return, report, certificate, financial statement, prospectus, etc., if there is a false statement, then what? A statement which is false and which is material and you report knowing it to be false. You make a statement that company has complied this, which is false. You know it is false, it is material, but still you have made a statement that company has complied with this particular provision. That is one. Number two, you do not disclose omission. You do not disclose something which is material, knowing that it is material and you are not disclosing it. Then there is a penalty. And penalties are prescribed in section 447, which is very, very nasty. Minimum imprisonment of 6 months, which can extend up to 10 years. And also with fine, which will be equal to the amount of fraud, or it may extend to 3 times the amount of fraud. Please remember, it is imprisonment and also with fine, it is not all. So imprisonment is definitely there. And such fraud, if it involves public interest, then minimum imprisonment is not less than 3 years. That is the provision in 447. Now what is fraud? Let us understand. Misstatement in your report is a fraud. You are aware that this particular thing is false and you are making a statement. Similarly, for example, company related party transactions, company has executed, entered into related party transactions, you know it, during the course of your audit, you have found that it is irregular, the company has siphoned money to the related party, and you don't like it.
or you write that company has duly complied with the provisions related to related party transactions, then this is a false statement. Secondly, 447 also describes, as 448 describes report and certificate, 447 says that fraud might not have been committed only by promoters. It can be committed in connivance with some other person. So auditor definitely, then when you protect or shield the promoter or the management, the fraud is committed in connivance with the auditor, financial auditor or secretary auditor. So consequences are very serious. It will lead to imprisonment and also with fine, which may be equal to the amount of fraud involved in fraud or three times the amount involved in fraud.
Thank you, sir. Friends, we are hard pressed for time, and we already received certain questions through the electronic system which has been set up by the institute. And let me share these questions with the panelists here, and you can, any of you can take your choice who wants to answer them, where the name is not specified. This is a general question. What is the professional indemnity available to the company secretaries under the event of fraud by any employee? Anybody wants to take that? What is the professional indemnity available to the company secretaries under the event of a fraud by any employee? Am I correct? This is the question. You are talking about employee company secretary or practicing company secretary? The gentleman who raised this question. Yes, sir.
So we were talking about a company secretary who is in employment, not a practicing company secretary.
Okay. Company secretary in employment committing a fraud, you mean to say?
You were mentioning that at times if the fraud has been done by somebody else, and
what is the role of the company secretary in employment?
Exactly.
What is the role of the company secretary in employment if an employee in the company has committed a fraud? Would you want to answer that?
So, as far as the employee company secretary is concerned, there is a policy called Directors and Officers Liability Insurance Policy, which covers the company secretary and directors and other employees only from civil actions, only from civil liabilities, of course. Of course, criminal actions have to be faced by the particular person if found guilty. And like my esteemed panelist said, nowadays you are guilty unless you are proved to be innocent. As far as role is concerned, the role could be one, proactive role of a whistleblower, and the role could be two, a reactive role where he discovers that fraud has happened and he himself has been a victim of that fraud. In such situation, as a post-mortem or as an after fact, he reports it to the management or to the auditor or to the regulator.
Thank you. Thank you, Siddharth. The next question is for Mr. Pradeep Ramakrishnan. Have you mic, sir? This is from Swaroop, C.A. Swaroop. BSE had released a corporate governance scorecard few years back. Why not make that more as benchmark to value compliances of the listed entities?
Were
you aware of it? I was not aware.
See, the regulator is not in the ranking business, and we shouldn't do it also. See, if you see a traffic policeman, a person who stands on the at the signal, he doesn't dole out the candy to him. But a person who crosses the signal while it is red, he doles out a challan to him. That is the job of a traffic policeman. So you are supposed to comply, and there are no brownie points for compliance. But people who don't comply, we are going to face the music. So SEBI or any regulator for that matter should not get into ranking and all those things. See, everyone is equal in the eyes of law. And we all know what has happened in the past, India and internationally, when companies have been ranked as good, the best, and all those things, only to face, only to show the darker sides some other time. So then, for example, in case it is endorsed or something by the regulator, then it will be something as to, we will have to, it's very clear, I don't think we should get into it.
I'm glad you stopped it. So the another question is from Mr. Puni. There's one. Instead of having a plethora of, all the company secretaries will be very happy with this, but it comes true. Instead of having a plethora of e-forms and other certifications, why can't we have
the central audit compulsory for all the companies with a fee prescribed structure. I'm sure all of you would be very happy with this. Mr. Puneet, will you stand up, please? I want the applause to be given to you, yeah? Kindly stand up. Hey, Ji, Puneet?
Actually, the name is recorded wrong. It's my name. Yeah.
Sorry, your name is Puneet, not Puneet.
I'm not Puneet, yes.
But you were the one who recorded this question. There's some defect in your electronic system of communication.
Nay,
doesn't matter. Let's have a round of applause for him. Thank you, thank you. That may not be possible. It's an utopian thing. Let's not think about it. The next question is filing balance sheet with ROC after 30 days. Now, this is a very interesting one. A poser which I would like to have Mr. Keyur Bakshi reply. Filing balance sheet with ROC after 30 days with additional fee. Would this default be mentioned in the second audit report?
I don't think it should be.
They have paid the fees. So if the penalty has been paid, then
it is condoned.
It's condoned. Therefore the question. So I got the panelist reply to whatever you wanted. Right? Thank you. The companies hire CS for namesake. Oh my god. Should I continue on this? I don't know who the name of the person, it's an anonymous one. Companies hire CS for namesake. Primary work done by CS is being legal head, FM, GM, etc. Compliance is secondary, which nothing but financial burden on them. Comment? I have no comments. I think we should not be talking about those people at all.
No, I let me tell you. If you are a company secretary of a stature, don't deal with such companies.
The next question. In case an assignment is denied due to non-compliance, or if same assignment is taken up and certified, what recourse is available to the professional who denies it? I think this is not for this panelist, we will not talk about it now. We can talk about it in person with any of us. We have certain, we have Mr. Manish Gupta who is here, who is the PCS committee head. He will be able to reply to you. Question to Pradeep. Can stock exchange send prescribed quarterly compliance checklist to all listed entities and also send a report regarding their non-compliances? Now, I think this is too much to ask from the regulator. That you tell me what all I need to comply, you tell me what all I have not complied. I think that is not the spirit.
You tell me what I have not done and please don't be enlisted.
Your question itself answers, right? To Mr. Hegde, sir. You have a question on Mahabharata, watch out for it. Mahabharata is referred everywhere. My friend Ashish Garg is here somewhere. Okay. But no one is talking about Sri Krishna, the government. Please answer.
Yeah.
That's what the question is. We are all stakeholders, but the irritation is about sudden introduction of compliances. We expect clear outline because of which the quality of compliances will further improve. Now, this is a general question, possibly you can take it up in tomorrow's open session when we have the full panel of all the council members sitting across and each one will take turn to bash you up, right? So, we will talk about that later. Now, on the Mahabharata front, you want to answer something?
Ask the question.
Mahabharata is referred everywhere, but no one is talking about Sri Krishna, the government. Yeah. Not the Sri Krishna Commission.
This is Gopal Krishna answering the question. If you look at Ramayana, Rama was the king, he was the elder brother there. He was the king, he ruled. So whenever we talk about government, we think of Ramarajya only. Krishna was the younger brother, he was never a king. If you look at the story throughout Mahabharata, Krishna was behind the screen, guiding different individuals at different points of time, making them to do the right thing. And wherever it was not right, he used some people, empowered them and ensured that those wrong things are put an end and right thing went to place. Krishna was the charioteer, he was not himself a warrior. That is why we do not talk much about Krishna, but remember all these government principles were taught by him. If you read Bhagavad Gita, it touches upon all the governance and ethical way of doing business in different ways, and he is the author, Lord Shri Krishna. So when we have to learn from him, then something is going wrong, he is not responsible for that. You can seek refuge under his feet and he will find a solution for it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I don't think anybody could have answered that better. This is a very interesting question. My friend next to me is itching to answer it. How do you perceive accountability for professionals for audit and certification?
It's all yours for a little while.
Do I have any other question? What is the question? How do you perceive
accountability for professionals for audit and certification?
Yeah, absolutely. You perceive accountability by only what you have to do as a professional. Accountability is what? Making sure that you do the right things, following the standards, being credible, and ensuring that whenever there is compliances to be reported, you report them properly. That's the way you can proceed your accountability to the regulators.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. This is again a very interesting suggestion, an anonymous one. Isn't it a better idea for the government to create a fund and pay the auditors from the fund rather than having the company pay the auditors? I don't know, wild dream, it's not going to come true. Let's not get the government into this. Shri Krishna will be Shri Krishna. This is another interesting question. Now I want your response as well, Mr. Pradeep. Some statement or qualification was missed in the second compliance report. We admit we have done a mistake in your SER. Can we highlight it in the second audit report? Will any action be taken against us?
Let's meet in private. This, like I was telling you, we are not here to hound the people. I mean, we are, this edifice is made up of all of us. Now, we always call the company secretaries, the chartered accountants, practicing professionals as governance professionals. So you are part of the governance. So we are not a standalone body, we are not people sitting in ivory towers out to cherry pick and hang people. So that's not our want.
But interestingly, one thing which I would like to also mention here is whatever appears as qualification in the second audit report need not appear in the second compliance report. In as much it does not relate to the security laws. But whatever appears in the second compliance report has to necessarily appear in the second audit report. Well, I will not take any further questions. We have almost out of time.
I want to ask
Mr. Srinivasan, you are always the last man, right? Okay, go ahead. Shoot.
After that, you check.
Yeah, it's on.
This is a question posed to Mr. Kayur Bakshi. You were saying that, apart from the report, you give a separate letter to the management pointing out certain non-compliance.
Observation.
Is it not dangerous? You are putting on record that you have not reported non-compliance. This company, in fact, or the regulation doesn't say what is not material compliance, don't report. Any non-compliance must be reported. Is it not better that you do it orally and then it's your role? Small compliance, I agree with you, that is the report of the solo. That is one. I want some suggestions to make. In fact, I have written an article about regulation. Now, two categories of people are, you know, the devil in the deep sea. One is the independent director, the other is the central auditor. There's a fear of losing the audit, there's a fear of losing an external or independent audit. Should not we propose that there are closed door meeting be held with the independent directors and the auditors, where none of the company representatives is present, and an independent director's report is attached to the annual report? The chairman of the independent committee, independent directors committee, will attach his report. That is why. Next, there must be a one-to-one meeting between the statutory auditor and the secretary auditor before the report is signed, because both of them should be on the same page. There are some overlapping, care of manager preparation, etc. When the secretary auditor says there is a violation, he says there is no violation. should not this not be introduced a mandatory requirement?
No, it is happening actually.
No.
See, as I told you, principle of materiality. Whatever observations which we include in the letter are absolutely non-material, which can be understood by reading.
What is material? What is
number two? Number two, in terms of punishments. If you have given something in writing, it can absolve you at a later date. That this was not material, and we have drawn attention of the management on the same. So therefore, you have not overlooked. That is the idea. Oral, you know, where is the evidence? Oral is not the evidence. So therefore, I would still suggest that we give a letter, but it should be only non-material. Otherwise, it has to be qualified.
Thanks, Gilbert. In terms of the other point which you were mentioning, yes, we have. I told you there is a single core group on settled law audit. We are working on it. I will request Mr. Vijayendra to meet up with you during the day or tomorrow to take your views, and we will take it how we can take it further. Now I hand over the mic to my good friend Siddharth Murarka.
So, thank you everyone. This was a wonderful panel discussion. I am here to place my concluding remarks for your consideration. So, friends, the topic for this panel discussion is audit and certification, professionals' accountability. Before I come to audit, let's talk about certification only. Most of my young colleagues, my young members, they start their practice with a typical DIR 12 certification and filing, is it not? Do you all agree with me? Every young practicing professional, the new practicing profession starts with a DIR 12. Is there not risk entailed in DIR 12 certification? I can give you a live example which happened in northeastern part of the country. One brother told one young practicing company secretary that my other brother has resigned from the board. This is his resignation letter, forged. Kindly upload it. The young friend did it. Before ROC or RD or MCA or some good authority could approach him, the CID, the state CID, arrested that young fellow. So there is risk not just in audit but even in small certifications. Friends, if you think today, we were also mentioning this esteemed panel was many times referred to Big Four, the Big Four audit firm. There was a Big Five, right? What was the name of the fifth firm?
Arthur Anderson
collapsed due to purportedly bad audit of Enron. But friends, the fact is Arthur Anderson did not collapse because of bad audit of Enron. It collapsed because of non-maintenance of working paper files.
No, they destroyed actually. That's the reason why they had to.
So friends, when I talk about secretarial audit and then we talk about retention of documents, which the esteemed panel was also mentioning, working paper file, whenever I talk to the MSOP guys, I say, working paper file is your LIC. Zindagi ke saath bhi aur zindagi ke baad bhi, audit ke saath bhi aur audit ke baad bhi. Because 4 years down the line, when the regulator comes and asks you difficult questions, my friend, please forgive me. When the regulator comes and asks you difficult questions, it is only the working paper file which can substantiate our professional independence and integrity. One question came from my esteemed member somewhere, the name was not mentioned, it was an anonymous question, that why is the auditor's payment not made by the government? And most of us laughed it away saying that it is wishful thinking. But friends, if a pool is generated from the corporates, the government is not going to fund it. Let us do wishful thinking. Now let me take it this way. Let the corporates contribute to a corpus of the government. From that corpus, let the audit fees be paid. The auditors and professionals are not scared of removal. They are not giving report to the person who is paying them. Phir dekho kya hota hai quality of audit and quality of certification. So sometimes wishful thinking can really do a lot of work. Friends, ILFS, one of my esteemed panelists was saying that yes, and I fully agree, the regulators, the judiciary, the media has to draw a line between professional negligence and criminal involvement. There could be human error, there could be professional judgmental error, there could be professional negligence, but that may not always be criminal in nature. So let's not try and hang the professionals for each and everything that happens.
But there's a difference between gross negligence and negligence.
Absolutely, sir. For example, there is a difference between default and willful default, right?
There is so, also a difference between trivial and substantial.
Trivial and substantial, and we have discussed about the concept of materiality. When we talk of ILFS, I spoke to one of my colleagues working at a very senior position in ILFS. He said, "Bhai, humne kuch nahi kiya." National Highway Authority, National Highway Authority of India, NHIA, is not paying us 4,000 crore rupees which we owe. What do we do? So they have cash crunch. So they are unable to deliver projects. They are unable to make repayments of loans and interest. So everything does not boil down to the auditors. Everything does not boil down to the professionals. And I think we as a fraternity, although this is National Conference of Practicing Company Secretaries, but when I use the word fraternity, I include all professional institutes and I say that let us convey this message to the government and to the ministry and to the regulators that boss, we are not always the culprits and let you not make us the scapegoat of everything. MRL, we also discussed management representation letter. This is something extremely, extremely funny and a double-edged sword. Now I give you two examples. Suppose I get audit of Coal India, right? So Siddharth Murarka will not go down inside the coal mine and stay there for 2 months and look whether there is compliance of mining laws or not, because we have to comment on industry specific laws. So I cannot stay down in the mine for 2 months to find out whether there is compliance or not. So if I take a management representation letter from Coal India, that's fine. But unfortunately, I have seen professionals taking management representation letter on compliance of SS1 and SS2. This rather proves ki aapne kuch kaam nahi kiya. You simply signed the report. So while working paper file is a LIC, the MRL is a double-edged sword which needs to be used extremely carefully. One of my esteemed panelists also mentioned that we should do quarterly audit. Excellent, excellent suggestion, and many companies do appoint at the beginning of the financial year. Again, it has two aspects. One, we have to be paid well to do quarterly audit. Second, if you are not paid well, we become benevolent audit consultants for throughout the year, because what they do, they keep calling you and saying, "Sir, hum ye kar le kya? Sir, kar le kya?" And if you don't answer, they will say, "Dekhe sir, agar aap nahi batayenge, toh baad mein audit qualification mat dijiye." So it is again a double edged sword. So friends, I think we last point that I'd like to mention about the straitjacket format for secretarial audit, of course. MR3, with due respect to everything and everyone, MR3 has probably done a lot of damage, because we have taken it as a jacket, a straight jacket, we have tried to fit into it many a times, not trying to apply brains and modify the format to reflect the needs. For example, one of my panelists was saying that if you are relying on a particular third party certification, we have to also justify what led us to rely on that certification. So those kind of things, we are not editing that format and not making suitable edits. So that may be one of the challenges in secretarial audit. But I think it was a great panel discussion. Thanks to the esteemed panelists. Thanks to all of you for a wonderful discussion.